War story. Whose photograph is this? So who told you your name is Major?
Yeah.
Most elegantly dispatches by German. Thank you.
May Christ now reach him with the words of eternal life, come blessed of my Father. And on that top there is the cross and sound underneath, the great cross here, reminding us that it's only through the death and resurrection of Jesus that we can enter into eternal life. The cross is the first symbol that we receive on the day of our baptism. Before the water is poured and our names are proclaimed, we are signed by the priest, parents, grandparents, with the mark of the cross on our foreheads, claiming us to be God's holy people. On that day, we are receiving the promise of eternal life. We pray for that now that that promise comes to fulfillment. In that to be received, that sign of the cross, may you now share completely in Christ's victory over sin and death. Brothers and sisters, we believe all the ties of friendship and affection which knit us as one throughout our lives do not unravel them. Confident that God always remembers the good we have done and forgives our sins, let us pray asking God to gather that to himself. Lord Jesus, our Redeemer, you willingly gave yourself up to death so that all might be saved and passed from death to life. We humbly ask you to comfort your servants in their grief and to receive passion into the arms of your mercy. You alone are the Holy One, you are mercy itself. By dying, you unlocked the gates of life for those who believe in you. Forgive past sins and grant them a place of happiness, light, and peace in the kingdom of your glory forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated now as we listen to the scripture readings of the
Response,
the Lord is my shepherd.
Surely goodness and and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Response.
Lord, have mercy on us.
Instant and returned to Jerusalem. There they found the 11, assembled together with their companions, who said to them, "Yes, it is true. The Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then they told their story of what had happened on the road and how they had recognized him at the breaking of the bread. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord Jesus Christ. Today we gather to commend him to God. Our first reading takes us right back to the Old Testament at the time of King Solomon. And it's a passage which over many, many generations and over many different traditions have brought great comfort and consolation to people, both in times of grief and sadness and mourning like today, or in times of happiness and celebration. And it juxtaposes these opposites in so many ways throughout the text. There is a time for everything. A time to be born and a time to die. Perhaps the bookends of all of our lives. None of us have a choice in that matter. We can't choose when we want to be born or when we die. That's all thing that's part of God's plan. And it goes on to continually put these opposites together. Time for gathering, a time for scattering, a time for building up, a time for breaking down, a time for planting, and a time for harvesting. For Pat, that journey began, as I mentioned, on the day of his baptism, when he was claimed as a beloved child of God. And from that time, over his life, he had been travelling on that journey. There have been times, I'm sure, when there was great rejoicing, also great sadness. Death of his wife, Agnes, many, many years ago, must have been a really difficult parting. And we pray that God they are be united together again. But our reading takes us to King Solomon. The wisdom of Solomon, legendary, and very much part of our daily speech sometimes. But Solomon, when asked by God to ask for anything he wanted, didn't ask for material things. He asked for the gift of wisdom, that he would be able to lead God's people. And we're told that God said to him, "Because you have asked for this, you will have a wisdom greater than any before you, and greater than any that will come after you." So these words that we hear from the book of Ecclesiastes from that period of Solomon give us great hope. Yes, there are tears and sadness in the parting of a loved one. And many, I suppose, in the theatrical profession or whatever, have a fan base much broader than perhaps we realize, of people who actually love them and who grieve more. our minds, whether we realize them or not, in many ways, through the characters that they bring into our minds, whether it be on stage, or in film, on television, whatever it is, they become part of our lives almost. And so, yes, there is grief, there is sadness. But grief, unfortunately, is the price that we have to pay for loving someone. And when they leave us, in some ways, they take part of us with them. So there's always a place for them, I suppose, a gap in our lives that can't be filled by anybody else. Our psalm, perhaps the best known of all of the psalms, the fact that the Lord is the shepherd who goes before us, even through the valley of the shadow of death, and he leads us to the banquet of eternal life, promising that we shall dwell forever in the house of the Lord. That's our destiny. That's our destination. It's the ultimate purpose of our journey in life. And we walk that journey not alone. The Lord, the shepherd, is there walking with us, perhaps unseen, unheard, perhaps at times unheeded, but walking with us, guiding us gently on the path towards life. And then our second reading, Paul at the end of his own life, realizing that the time had come, that he was preparing for his departure, says, I'm ready to go. I have done what was asked of me. I have kept the faith. Now all that awaits me is the crown of eternal life. And not only for me, but for all who love and hope for the Lord's appearing. Paul spent his whole life trying to rebuild what he had tried to destroy. We first meet him as Saul of Tarsus, setting out, particularly on a journey, to round up all the followers of the Lord Jesus, to take them off to prison and probably certain death. And on that road to Damascus, he has that wonderful encounter with the risen Christ. And he says, who are you, Lord? And the voice replies, I am Jesus whom you are persecuting. In the members of the Christian community, Paul was persecuting the Lord himself. And Paul, as he becomes, totally changes his life. Complete transformation. And he goes on to build up the church, to spread the good news, to proclaim the gospel for the rest of his life. Our gospel this morning, I've particularly chosen jumping forward from these Lenten days to the great days of Easter, and to that very first, it's Easter Sunday morning. It's a very human situation. Two of the disciples, we're told, are on their way out of Jerusalem, trying to put all that had happened behind them. They had so much hope for the future that now seems to be dashed. And as they walk along, talking over all that had happened, the risen Lord appears by their side, but unrecognized because he's now in his glorified body. And in many ways, he tries to draw them out. And it seems as if you get a sense of the humor of Jesus. What are you talking about? How could you be coming to Jerusalem and not know? Tell me about it. And they just can't quite get to grips that anybody wouldn't have seen and known what had happened. So they begin to recount all the things about their friend Jesus and how much they had looked forward to the future. And now all that seems to be taken from them and dashed. And I'm sure in the past few days since Pat passed, many of you have been recalling Pat, different project perhaps that you worked on with him on stage or film, or even just personal relationships and things, because that's what we do. We gather, we talk, we remember, and in that way we keep the person alive in some ways. They're still part of our lives and who we are, and that's important, that we keep that alive. Those who've gone from us are only gone from our sight. One of the great images for me here, so close to the harbour, is that great image of the ship sailing away. and people standing on the pier waving to relatives and friends as they drift off, and watching and waving until eventually the ship disappears over the horizon. In that instant, the ship has not ceased to exist, nor have the passengers on board. They're still there as large as they ever were. The limit is in our vision. I believe it's the same with those who've gone back to God. They're still part of our lives, they're still there, but we can't see them. But we can still communicate with them, we can talk to them. They may not answer us in the way we would expect, but they can still be part of our lives. I think that's important for us. Because those who die have gone over them to God. And so Jesus calls out the faith of these two disciples. Were so defeated and crestfallen, and he explains the scriptures. He takes them right back to Moses and all the way down through the scriptures, talking about all that had been written of how the Christ would have to suffer to enter into his glory. And they still fail to comprehend. It's only when they gather at table, as they had done just a few days before, Jesus takes the bread and blesses and breaks it, as we ourselves will do in a few moments during our Mass. And suddenly, in that instant, they recognize his presence. Their faith is rekindled. They have courage to face the future, to continue on their journey. And in that instant, he disappears from their sight. They can't see him, but they know he's present. And they rush back with this alarming news to Jerusalem. And they always think it's a little bit like a slap in the face. Yes, we know he's been here as well. He's already appeared to Simon. And they explain how they had met this man on the road, this character in a sense that they didn't know or recognize, who talked about so many wonderful things with them. But it was only in that moment of the breaking of the bread, Lord promised he would be with us forever, and that simple sign that they recognized him. He had done what he had to do, which was to strengthen them and give them the courage they needed to face the future. I think from, again, a little bit of reading over the weekend, others are going to speak in much more detail about that later on. From a little bit of reading, the last project that Pat was working on is in post-production, called appropriately laid to rest. Today, that's our prayer for Pat. We lay him to rest in God's loving care. In assurance, I hope that in God's own good time, because there is a time for everything, he will gather us together again with Pat and with all our loved ones who have gone before us at the banquet of eternal life. Can I invite you to stand up for our prayer? We turn to you, God our Father, with our need. We know that you hear and answer the prayers of your people, so we place our petitions before you in confidence.
Let us pray in thanksgiving in the light of the Pat for all the love he gave, for all the many ways through which he touched the lives of others.
We pray for all Pat's deceased relatives and friends, especially his wife Eileen and his current daughter. Lord, hear us.
We pray for all here present that our remembrance of Pat may be a source of comfort and strength. Lord, hear us.
Lord, grace and
be yours. We meet our son Lord Pat, and Diary Dice and Arakin, Smith Conline, our intelligence of his radio.
Ashtori, Sturahori, Shkelahe, Shumtori, Devahori, Jahori, Banishtori, Slaicha, Magazella. The Vaishikulair Solas, in a mort, Agus in a world. We pray for all the doctors, nurses, and carers in St. Vincent's Hospital, and for all the other medical professionals who have helped Pat over the years. Lord, hear us.
Just take a moment in the silence of our hearts to place our own prayers for Pat and our own needs. Saddened by the certainty of dying, might be consoled by the promise of immortality.
immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for us in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. Holy, 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 holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory, O Son of the Highest. Heaven and sea opens in the name of the Lord, O Son of the with your blessed apostles and glory. whom you have called from this world back to your Son. Grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection, when from the earth you would raise up in the flesh those who have died and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages, and praise you without end through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him.
Far away. Now, upon you, Amen. So many people loved the old curmudgeon dearly. For all his legendary gruffness, Pat had a remarkable gift for friendship and an almost fatherly way of looking out for people. Marco Regan tells us more. Good morning. I often think that the theatre community is a bit like a tribe. And in every tribe there's always a wise chief to offer good counsel and to keep you on the straight and narrow. And Pat was always there with his sound judgment, delivered in that unique, matter-of-fact way. On a recent conversation about antidepressants, he said, there's an antidepressant for every day of the year. Sometimes a long, intelligent walk can be just as good. He was a bit of an expert, actually, on medical matters. If you had an ailment, the chances are he probably had it too. When I told him last year that I had a condition called plantar fasciitis, which is a very painful condition in your heel area, he said, I had a dose of that once, but it goes away. And I said, how long will I have it? And he replied, it'll be a good year before it clears up. And he was right. Because he was a qualified engineer, I once asked him to have a look at a house that I had just bought, which was in need of total refurbishment. He said, it's a grand house, but it will probably take you about 10 years to finish it. He was right again. He loved good gossip, but you had to be hard off the presses with it, or else you'd get, actually, I heard that weeks ago. That's been doing the rounds for ages. If you told him that a couple had split up, his first response would be, is there a torn party involved? Being in his company was like being in a Beckett play, with a sprinkling of flannel brine thrown in for good measure. I was fortunate enough to spend a few hours with him last Tuesday. And when he woke up, his brain was like a pinball machine. We moved seamlessly through a diverse range of topics. Opera singing, the soft ground in Cheltenham, the state of the Abbey, and his worry that Ireland might get mauled in Cardiff, and he was right again. He was philosophical about death, and he quoted his favourite poet, Philip Larkin, about going to the inevitable. He was sanguine about it all, and he said that he'd enjoyed himself. And I said, you've done the state some service, and he shot back immediately, they know it, no more of that. I thanked him for picking me out of a lineup and opening a door for me to come into the business in 1984 as an entertainer in the Poe Castle, part of the Bunratty Group. It was a dream gig for both of us. You can imagine him surrounded by beautiful singers and harpists at the beginning of the summer. At that time, he loved holding court in the presidential suite of the Shannon Shamrock Hotel, wearing dark glasses and smoking goulwas, so petre. He looked like a bomb villain. He'd pop by occasionally that summer to see that I was behaving myself. I wasn't, and he knew it. I think that we'd all miss that fierce intelligence, the sound advice and judgment, that wonderful esprit de corps when he arrived at a cricket ground wearing a fancy straw hat. When American chiefs die, they don't die actually, they just walk on. I can see him now, his broad shoulders striding towards a point on the horizon. Are you a shake or a banana? You better get a head out of reach. president of the Theatrical Cavaliers Cricket Club, he declared, taking his cue from some notorious African despot, that he wanted to be named president in life and death. He served the Cavaliers with enthusiasm and dignity for many years, and cast a powerful, if ungainly, figure in Greece. His player profile records in answer to the question, which cricketer do you model yourself on and why? W.G. Grace, for carrying Avoyage Bar with style. Pat Laffin was born in Beauport, County Meath, in June 1939, just before the outbreak of the emergency. Full details of his childhood, for those interested, can be found in the dramatic monologue, The Boyhood of Laffin, penned by a young admirer, Sam Ford, and performed at Theatrical Cavaliers annual dinner some years ago. The work explores some of Pat's key influences: his wet nurse, his nanny, his first pedal-powered automobile, and his first experience of a Punch and Judy show. And it culminates in the infant Laffin saluting a squadron of Heinkels on their way to bomb the North Strand. "Guter Glück, meine Jungen," he cries. "I never liked that part of town anyway." In reality, young Pat secured a place at UCD, where he qualified as an engineer, and briefly flourished in that most respectable profession. But the magical allure of the theatre, inspired by a theatre-loving uncle, by school experiences of Guildford and Sullivan, proved too strong, and he strayed into the Abbey Company in the early 1960s. The rest, as they say, is history. Fellow Abbey veteran, Clive Geraghty, remembers those days.
"I'm as weak as a dog." How often did a satisfying day's work start only words for Pat? I can safely say that I learned more from Pat than from any other man ever. He was intelligent, well-read, totally honest, and non-judgmental. I don't know how many times we worked together, but every occasion was an enjoyable experience. When we were rehearsing the Silver Tassie, he was playing Harry, I was playing Teddy, and Hugh Watts, and Pat Laffin's inspiring production. He said to me one day that in order to get the theme of the First World War, I should read some of the poets who wrote the poems. Sassoon, Wilfred Owen, Robert Graves, which I did. And I went on to read Graves' autobiography of that period, Goodbye to All That. And that led me on to his other books, I Thought His Bodies to God. And these, in turn, led me on to Tacitus, Suetonius, and Pat had started a chain reaction that went on for years. But he wasn't only really knowledgeable about literature and the arts, he also had a practical streak. For some unknown reason, I decided at one time to get fit and to start jogging, much to the amusement of my family. And this resulted in me getting a very uncomfortable heat rash and chatting at the tops of my legs. Pat and I were in the same restaurant at the time, and he told me to go to a chemist and get a big bottle of cheap eau de cologne and lash it on. He told me it would sting like hell, which it did, and that I would smell like a tart, which I did. But it did the trick. When we played together in Michael Harding's Sour Grapes, we shared the dressing room in the Peacock. And Pat was having terrible trouble with his teeth. His mouth was generating an enormous excess of saliva, which made his long speeches and difficult dialogue very, very, very hard. But he persevered. He attacked the part every night with his fierce passion and talent, and gave an outstanding performance. He was also having trouble at that time with his back, and he complained one night after having a shower in the Peacock that he was having difficulty cutting his toenails. It still shames me that We went on tour with that day, and he and I played golf all over Ireland. The golf was abysmal, a pleasure for the enormous. A few hours after hearing of Pat's death, an old ash tree in our backyard came crashing down. I'm not going to invoke the pathetic fallacy, but its replacement is going to be called Pat's tree. Carved on Oliver St. John Logarty's gravestone in Ballinakil, in Connemara, are the words, "Our friends go with us as we go down the long path where beauty wins, where all love foregathers, so why should we fear to join our friends?" Slán mé. Éist ag raibh an bhíolas agus is fíor é ach mhaoin a bhí hé do rí seo.
Great friend and neighbor, and it will never be the same again.
say au revoir to my life.
Oh, good.
I don't know when I first met
ourselves like a child in front of some strange, unapproachable adult. But as time went on, when we worked together and toured together and played cricket together and went to the races together and drank good wine and then cheese and grapes in tawdry dressing rooms, we got to know each other and we became very close. And so much so that we treated each other almost like adults. So much so that 10, 11 days ago in the hospital, he told me that he was moving on. We spoke about life and death, and I said to him that we had served together before the Mass, and he said, yes, indeed we did. He said, you gave me a job once when I needed it. I directed him in a play I wrote once. And he said, and I gave you a job when you probably needed it too. And I said, you did. And one of his mantras in direction was, stand up straight, let them see your face, and don't be ready. While they're at it, don't try. I wrote this for you in 2002, and I call it In Good Humor and Bad. Known sometimes as the famous grouse, sometimes the moving crib. I don't suffer from depression, he objected strongly once. No, you enjoy it, I said. I walk the pier for exercise, and back, he said, extending his arms and stretching his belly for breath. Good for the body, he said. And the vista, I said, tapping the head. Good for the mind, I said. But then I thought, he said, of the labor of slaves, and all of the awfulness that went into buildings, and then all the murders, the people who might have met a bad end, and that poor fellow last week who fell or jumped or was pushed to his death. I brought you some things for the new house, the moving crib, the famous grouse said. Strawberries, I got these on the road, and champagne, and the football, and the New Yorker magazine for the job. A gift of a golf club that somebody close had gifted to him. Another time, wine, and curious books that I dip into still. He should be called the giver, I said, not the grouse, not the crib. His pessimism entertains me. His worries make my worries fade. I'm amused how life's a conundrum has it. But then I thought, is he giving me lessons in the paranoid straight? Thank you, Martin.
Half obediently pulled his nightshirt over his knees I thought briefly of a scene in the early 1940s in a farmhouse in Donnerstown, County Meath, when no such modesty was required by his doting mother or her little engineer. But the big engineer was never one for doing what he was told. And when he became an actor in the Abbey Theatre a week after graduating, his doting mother had to telephone Ernest Blythe. Your mother wants me to fire you. What have you to say to that? Well, then I'd like to stay, but I'll give you an extra pound a week. You can deal with your mother. Round. We talked briefly of jelly babies, grapes, and other useless hospital gifts. Here, have a hit out of that, he said, and I dutifully sipped from the proffered hip flask. Smooth, I said. Brandy, Hennessy, clears the mouth. Nice. Mention not next time bring brandy. Next time I'll bring him whatever he wants. Do you want anything? No. Gentlemen's passing attractions no longer held any great interest on the TV at the end of the bed. Mia had an 80-1 come third earlier on, but the record failed. I managed to extract two wholehearted belly laughs from him without causing bronchial disruption, and I marveled at how the oxygen and other medicaments were doing their work. I reflected on how happy he was. Sitting propped up in the bed, joking, laughing, buoyant. The famous grouse was now the happy animal, as he blissfully enjoyed his equanimous cocktail. He was in tune, coherent and clear, in sync with the time. Well, you know the situation, he said to Michael and me and myself, in a rhetorical sort of way, no hint of the mildly terminal message he had sent to Colin me. Well, I'm happy enough, he said. Maybe that's not exactly what he said, but that's what he meant. And as he was always a man to say what he meant, I was happy to take him at his word. This time the hip flask passed silently. And in that earthbound hesitation, Michael, considering the show he had to do, I on my fourth or fifth sub, considering the drive home, what the Pat appeared untroubled, without a care in the world, and, dare I say it, content that all was done. I've not spoken to him with such a relaxed and easy manner since I first encountered this colossus in the mid-70s, when he acted and directed with great skill, was a willing mentor, and so deeply impressed some of us young lads that we even started to talk like him. Michael and Ingrid, his faithful friends, had helped him to put his affairs in order. He could relax now. Time to go. Mia had left. Michael, Ingrid, and I had left with thoughts of tomorrow. And then, after a short rest, Pat left too, leaving a trail of funny stories, sagas, epithets, anecdotes, and aphorisms scattered like confetti in his wake.
Conquers all things, destroying even death itself. bread and life, our bodies are the dwelling place of God's Holy Spirit. Open the gates of paradise to your servant and help us